Morning. We're going to go back to Judges chapter 6. So if you got that Android, you got that iPad or that iPhone, grab it right now and turn with me to Judges chapter 6. We're going to pick back up in the story of Gideon today and kind of remember and reflect back with me, and then we're going to jump on where we're going today. Now, I was talking to you last week about how Gideon was scared to death. Gideon was a farmer, and there were these people called the Midianites, and the Midianites were a warring tribe. They were a nomadic tribe, and so they wouldn't bother to plant and to do things. They would just come down and raid the fields and then steal the livestock from the Israelites. And so on this one particular day, Gideon is hiding in what's called a wine press. It was kind of like, it would be almost like a cellar. And he was threshing out wheat. Now, normally, when you would thresh out wheat, you would be up on top of something called a threshing floor, where the wind would be blowing, and you'd take those stalks of wheat and you would beat them out. And as you were beating them and the wind was blowing, it would blow away the chaff, and then you would have, you know, the kernels that you wanted to be able to eat would be left behind. But he's hiding in this wine press because he's afraid of the Midianites. He's scared to death, and so he's in there, and he's threshing out wheat, and all of a sudden, an angel of the Lord is appearing before him. And the angel of the Lord looks at him. Now, again, remember where he is because of his fears. He's down in a cellar. He's not up top. He's down there hidden away. And yet the angel looks at him and says, "Oh, hell, valiant warrior, the Lord is with thee." And then in that moment, you hear Gideon ask a question that could be taken one of two ways. Did Gideon say, then, "Oh Lord, then why have all of these things befallen us?" Or did he say it in an attitude of, "If God is so for us, then why don't you tell me why all of these bad things have happened?" And then Gideon goes on and says, "And where are those miracles that our forefathers saw?" You know, when they were able to see the Red Sea part, when they were able to be fed for those 40 years in the wilderness by manna from God, when there was a pillar of fire that was there during the day, a pillar of smoke during the day and a column of fire at night representing the presence of God. And Gideon says, "Why doesn't that God show up? You know what? Why isn't he showing up right now?" And you know, in the midst of all that we're going through, isn't that sometimes what courses through your mind? I mean, you might not say it out loud, and you might not talk to your family about it, but I guarantee you there are times that you're sitting there and you're going, "God, why in the world are we going through this COVID-19? Why are we going through this situation? Why have we been quarantined now for a couple of months, and you're finding out the fabric of your family about right now and how much more you think you can take?" Well, number one, you can take a lot more than you think, and days are going to get better. But maybe you're in that category of Gideon of just going, "Hey, God, how about some miracles for us? How about that you change up some things for us?" And so Gideon going through this experience and having this opportunity to be able to discuss it with the angel is pretty remarkable territory. Now remember, I told you last week that we're always going to go through tests in our life. There are going to be, you know, these trials that are going to come through our life, and there's going to be temptations. So if you put the word trial right in the middle, if you're a note taker, and on the left side put that we're going to have some temptations in life, and on the right side that God is going to test us in life, and often the very same trial is used by God, and the very same trial is used by the devil. And so God is going to test us to bring out the best in us, to help us to be able to stand and to rise above. And the devil's going to be over here tempting you to bring out the worst in you, to make you stumble and fall. And one of the fundamental things that I've always taught is that when you're going through a trial, when you're going through that situation, do the things right now in the middle of the difficult times that later when you tell the story of how you responded, about how you navigated the situation, that you won't have to change a thing because you did it the right way. So live your story right now the way you want to be able to tell it later without having to change one thing. And listen, all of us are going through the stresses, all of us are going through the trials. So the first point last week was God uses trials to refocus our attention. You know what happens when times are good? We tend to forget about God. We get distracted by all the things that are out there that can take our attention away from God. The reason more people are going to church right now than ever before, and yet the physical locations have been shut down by and large, is because people have less things to distract them. They don't have the ball game schedule. They don't have the cheerleading practice. They don't have the dance. All the other competitive things that are always competing for your time. And so now you've settled into a pattern to where you're listening more to the Word of God, you're studying more, and I believe this is where God can do His greatest miracle because He's had more focused time from us than we've had in probably our entire lifetimes. So God uses the trial then to refocus our attention. And then remember this, God's perspective on who we are is not based on our prior performance. This is where I really want to begin to get into things today. And I'll begin in verse 12 of the chapter 6 that I started quoting earlier. Then the angel of the Lord appeared to him, Gideon, and he said, "The Lord is with you, mighty warrior." You know why God called him a mighty warrior? You say, well, he's a farmer, he's scared to death, he's not a warrior, he's hiding and he's scared. But that's not what God sees. You see, God sees us as we can be and not just as we are. I mean, doesn't that bring you hope today? Doesn't that excite you today to think that, you know what? God doesn't just see me the way that I am. He doesn't just see me in my addictions. He doesn't just see me in my anxieties. He doesn't just see me in my struggles. But the way that God sees me is that God sees me the way that I can be, not just the way that I am at this moment. And I believe that the reason the angel of the Lord, and this, by the way, is Jesus in the Old Testament. I told you last week, it's called a Christophany. That's when Jesus appears in the Old Testament. And so here he is, and I believe that he knew what he was obviously going to make Gideon to be, and now it was time for Gideon to see it himself. I wish so bad that you could see yourself the way that God sees you. The potential, the way that God put you together, the way that God knitted you together in your mother's womb. He's got so many incredible things planned for your life. But you know, without faith, it's going to be impossible to be able to please Him. And so right now, Gideon has a faith issue in his life, and he's got fear that's dominating his life. And remember, fear and faith cannot coexist in the same mental space. One is going to push the other out. And what you have to do is you have to learn to feed the side that you want to dominate your mind, because that's where you're going to be making your decisions from. And you don't want to make decisions based on fear. You want to make decisions based on faith. And faith is your reaction to God's ability, not just to your own ability. And one of the biggest lies that we tell ourselves is that God only uses special people. Well, you've got to have this gift or you've got to have that gift. That is so not true. And that's why earlier I was talking about the preacher in North Carolina, Fred Lunsford. And here's this pastor, 95 years old. He was there on the day that they landed on the beaches at Normandy. He fought in the Battle of the Bulge. He's been this man that when he came home, he was committed to his church. He pastored one church for over 50 years, and it's the toughest sounding church name I've ever heard in all of my 45 years of being in ministry. He pastored the Vengeance Creek Baptist Church. Now, buddy, you got to be a tough pastor right there. You can't be a sissy pastor in a church called Vengeance Creek. You've got to be tough. And so here's Fred, this mountain preacher whose wife has passed away, and he just said, "Lord, why don't you just take me on home?" And the Lord said, "Nope, I want you to start a prayer movement. I want you in Marble, North Carolina, 95 years old and blind, I want you to start a prayer movement that would attract 100 ministers to come to the mountain and pray." And now it's turned into, as of this morning, 170,000. I wouldn't be surprised by the time that it gets here that there's 250,000. And you know what that shows you? That it's about your availability and not your ability. Brother Fred doesn't have the ability to do social media and try to create a viral sensation. Brother Fred is blind, and it takes other people helping him to even get up to the mountain where he goes to pray. But it is a perfect illustration of what God can do in your life. And so God uses ordinary people in an extraordinary way, and you're extraordinary. You say, right. So why am I so extraordinary? Well, number one, if you know Jesus, you're God's child. According to John chapter 1, verse 12, "But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, even those that believe in his name." And listen, if you're sitting there today and you're not sure if you're a Christian, if you're struggling right now and you're saying, "Well, you know, I don't know that I've ever truly given my life to Christ," I want to lead you in a prayer right now, where you can nail that down right here in the beginning of this message, so that the first point is that you're going to know that you're God's child. So I'm going to ask you where you are. I'm going to keep my eyes open, and I'm going to pray for you, and you can look directly in the TV if you choose to do it that way. But here's the prayer I want you to pray. Are you ready? Just say, "God," and say it out loud. "God, I acknowledge that you are. I believe on the name of Jesus. I confess my sin. God, I'm not perfect, but I know that you are perfect. So I confess you as my Lord. I confess you as my CEO of my life. I want you to push out my ego, God, and I want you to be the CEO of my life." And just say to him, "Help me not to be ashamed of you, Lord Jesus. Come into my heart right now. Save my soul. Thank you now for saving my soul." And pray, "In the name of Jesus, I ask these prayers. Amen." Wherever you are in this moment, if you just prayed that prayer, I want you to know that it's not about praying a magical prayer in an order. It's about giving your heart and your life to Jesus. So why do I believe that God can use you in extraordinary ways? Because you're a child of God. Did you also know that now that Jesus calls you his friend? That's in John 15:15. Don't you like it when someone says, "I'm your friend"? He says, "No longer do I call you slaves, for the slave does not know what his master is doing. But I've called you to be my friends. For all the things," now think about this, this is Jesus saying this to you, "for all of us that know him," for those of you that just ask him into your heart, he says, "Because everything I've heard from my Father, I'm now going to make known to you." And that's because the Holy Spirit comes to live in our life. You know why else you ought to be excited? You're God's masterpiece. Ephesians 2:10, for we are his workmanship, and we've been created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we would walk in them. When he says there, we're his workmanship, another word that's easily interchangeable is that we're his masterpiece. And we've also been justified. According to Romans chapter 5, verse 1, and you said, well, what do you mean justified? It says, therefore, having been justified by our faith, and our faith is trusting and taking God at his word, whether it's your Bible that you're reading or in the prayer time as God speaks to your heart, when we trust him, we are then justified. And justified means it's just as if I'd never sinned. You're justified right now in this moment. And you know what that means for you? According to Romans 5:1, we now have peace with God through the Lord Jesus Christ. See, you can never have the peace of God until you know the peace of God in your life. And you now have it. And you know, for those of you that feel guilty, maybe you've just really made a mess of your life, maybe you've torn it up, but you know, now you're freed from the condemnation of God. Have you ever worried that one day you're gonna be standing before God and you're gonna have to answer for every sin that you've ever committed, every mistake that you've ever made in your life? That is not true. Romans 8:1 says, now therefore there is no condemnation to those that are in Christ Jesus. So that means everything that we've ever done has been forgiven, and everything that we might ever do has been forgiven through the person of Jesus Christ, because that work that Jesus did on the cross is when he justified you before God, and all we have to do is ask him into our life. And now your citizenship is in heaven. You've been adopted into God's family. That's Ephesians chapter 1, verse 5. And now your citizenship is in heaven. Philippians chapter 3, verse 20. You ought to be feeling good. For our citizenship is in heaven, for which we eagerly wait for our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. So now you belong to God. You're here. You're his. And according to 1 Corinthians 6:20, it says, for we've been bought with a price. Therefore, we should glorify God in our body. And so that means in the way we live our life, that means in the choices that we're going to make. And for a guy like Gideon, it meant you've got to stop looking through these old lens and listening to those old tapes that run through your head about you're not worthy, you're not this, you're not that. And maybe you had someone pounding that garbage into your head. I'm telling you that you are a child of God. When that angel was looking at Gideon, all the things that I'm sharing with you that would have been active from the perspective of God being at work in his life was in effect in those days as well. And that's why Jesus himself went to give that message in the Old Testament, and he's called an angel of the Lord. But you know what? The news gets even better, because now you'll never be separated from his love, according to Romans chapter 8, verse 35. And boy, do I love this passage of Scripture. Who will separate us from the love of Christ, it says? Will tribulation, will distress, will persecution, will famine, nakedness, peril, or sword? He says, no. In all of these things, we overwhelmingly conquer through him that loved us. We conquer by living our lives through Jesus. For I am convinced, the Apostle Paul said, and this is the part that I love. I am convinced, Paul said, that neither death, neither life. In other words, he's saying, none of these things can ever separate you from God. When you die, you already have eternal life. The moment you ask Jesus into your life, your eternal life starts in that moment. You're never going to die. Physically, you're going to die. Spiritually, you're going to live forever. So listen, with all of the fear, with all of the things that are going on today, for those of us that are believers, we've got an eternity in heaven that is waiting for us. And if you don't have Jesus, it's an eternity separated and away from God and away from His presence. And so Paul said, hey, look, I'm telling you, death is not going to separate you from God. And I find this so interesting, nor life. See, some of you go, I do believe that when I die, I'm going to go to heaven. But right now, you feel condemned all the time. You listen to those bad tapes that are there in your mind about what you're not and what you've never achieved in your life. And yet, Paul is saying right here, I don't care what you've done in your life. And boy, wouldn't Paul need this. Because Paul was the guy who persecuted Christians. Paul was the guy on his way to Damascus when he was struck down by a blinding light saying, Paul, why are you persecuting my people? And when he said, who is this? He said, it's Jesus Christ that you're persecuting. Do you know that Paul stood there and he held the robes when the people stoned to death the first Christian martyr, Stephen? Paul stood there and held their robes. You talk about somebody that could have said, no, man, I've done too many things in my life. I've been divorced too many times. I've messed this up. I've gone through addiction. I've been in treatment. I've done this. I've done that. You can come up with your list, but I'm telling you that God loves you, God cares for you, and if you'd have been the only person that ever lived, Jesus Christ would have come and died for you. And you say, for me, I'm talking about for you. So let me finish this list. For I'm convinced that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities nor things present, there's not going to be anything to come. There's not going to be a power. There's not going to be a height. There's not going to be a depth. There's not going to be any other created thing, the Apostle Paul, that's going to be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Wow. Do I love that passage? Man, y'all ought to be shouting in your house right now. You ought to be raising your hands going, wow, COVID-19 can't separate me from the love of God. Their social distancing can't separate me from the love of God because God resides right here inside of me in the person of the Holy Spirit. And everything you need from Him for life and for godliness, God already knows who you are, even if in the moment you don't know who you are. God knows who you are, and He knows who you can be, and He'll help you to get to the point where you can see His true identity. So here's what God does for us next. God confirms His presence by His power. So God uses the trial to refocus us, and then God's perspective is not based on our prior performance, a scared Gideon. And after being called that mighty warrior, that's where Gideon gave the question to God and to the angel of the Lord. He says, then please, sir, if the Lord is with us, then why has all these things happened? And where are all these wonders that our fathers told us about? You know what Gideon was saying? He was saying, God, I feel like you've abandoned me. I feel like you have abandoned me and you have turned around and you have walked away from me. When we feel abandoned, it's because we don't feel God's sense of presence. But when we continue to sin and to sin and to sin and to sin, then God's presence is going to dissipate from being there with us. And so it was time for Gideon to get his act together. It was time for the nation of Israel to get its act together. And so what God did was He called Gideon to be the instrument that He was going to use because He saw a character trait in him from the beginning that He knew he could end up being that mighty man of valor, not because of anything inherently Gideon had, but he could be a mighty man of valor because of who God is. And God is ultimately the mighty man of valor. Men, we should live our lives. Women, we should live our lives. Boys and girls, so that God lives through us and we represent Him. That's what we all need to be doing. And so God had called Gideon to deliver His people, but more importantly, He called Gideon to be something different. You should be learning something about yourself during these days of isolation. You're probably making promises to God right now. If you'll let me survive my family, I'll go to church every Sunday the rest of my life. I'm going to remind you of that when we're finally coming back to church. But He called Gideon to be different than what he was at the moment of his calling. And in God's hands, Gideon was going to become a mighty man of valor. Now, if you look at verse 14 in chapter 6, it records something that must have overwhelmed Gideon in the moment. Because just because God has said, this is who you're going to be, doesn't necessarily mean that all of a sudden you fully embrace it. Because then the angel of the Lord turned to him and looked Gideon full in the face, and he said, I want you to go in your strength, and I want you to deliver Israel from the power of Midian. Am I not sending you? Can you imagine how Gideon felt right there? And he says, man, let me tell you, I'm not worthy of this. He had a predecessor named Moses that said the same thing. When God said, I want you to go, and I want you to go to Pharaoh, he said, Pharaoh's not going to listen to me. And he said, and if I go and tell him, then whose name am I telling him I'm coming in? And God said, you tell him that I am that I am has sent you to Pharaoh to confront him. And so God gives Gideon the same answer that He gave Moses, because God looked at Moses and said, hey, I'm going to be with you. You're going to go in my strength. You see, that's the key. Gideon's strength is not in himself, but Gideon's strength is in the promise that God has made that I'm going to be with you. And so God's vision of Gideon and God's promise to be with him absolutely radically changed Gideon's life, because the Lord had made this great promise. He needs a lot of Christians to get radical. He needs a lot of us to step up and to be what God has called us to be. But you know what he immediately goes to? He goes to his prior history. He goes back to his history. And here's what he says in verse 15. He says, my Lord, I am anything but a mighty warrior right here. He says, I'm telling you, my situation is bad. This is Judges 15. My family is the poorest in Manasseh. And Manasseh then is the poorest tribe that's there, and I'm the least in my father's house. He's saying we live at the end of a dead end, and we've got a shotgun house, and I'm sleeping in the very back bedroom that's more like a closet. Hey, God, I don't have the pedigree to be able to do that. And the Lord says to him, I'm telling you, I'm going to be with you. I'm going to be with thee. And that's the promise that God is making to you today. Do you realize that the feeblest man with God in his life is mightier than the strongest man on this earth without God? And once man and God get together, let me tell you what, they make a majority in any scene, in any incident, in any nation, any time, any age, now and forever. I will be with thee. And that's what God is promising you today. And that's what God is promising me today when we're going through this COVID-19 and we're practicing the social distancing and we're wondering, is the economy going to bounce back? Are things going to come back? When God is with us, anything is possible. And in verse 16, God says, I'm going to be with you. And listen to this. You're going to strike down Midian as if it is one man. Gideon is given an undeniable commission. He's told the results in advance. When you already know you're going to win the battle, you ought to be confident. You ought to be strong, knowing that God is there. And so everything starts falling into place for Midian. And then Midian realizes, oh my goodness, I'm conversing with God himself. Now, he wouldn't have understood the Trinity and all the other things more than likely, but he yells out in verse 22, oh no, Lord God, I have seen the angel of the Lord face to face, and his fears are now controlled. His calling is affirmed. He does what I told you some about last week. He builds an altar to the Lord. He has a personal encounter with him there in verse 23, and God says to him as the angel of the Lord, peace, do not be afraid. You're not going to die. And Gideon builds this altar. Now listen, and he names it, the Lord is peace. The Lord is peace. Do you notice what God has just done? He's called Gideon to be the general in charge of an army that doesn't exist. And he said, you're going to go knock down the Midianites as one man. And yet, Gideon says, you know what? I'm going to build an altar that says, the Lord is peace. You know what it is? In the days that we're in right now, what is the true peace of God? Because the Hebrew thought pattern is different than our thought pattern. And when we think about peace, when we think about it, we think, well, peace in a war would be the cessation of hostilities. It would be the eradication of stress in my personal life. But for the Hebrews, their understanding of peace had nothing to do with the absence of hostilities or the eradication of stress. The idea of peace for them was that things are in order. That things are in order. Do you know that God goes behind us, that God goes with us, and that God goes before us? He's our bookends. So what Gideon is saying is, I'm going to find myself in an extremely hostile situation. I'm sure it's going to cause all kinds of stress in my life, but there's one thing I know. In all of my weakness, I will abandon myself to who the Lord is. Now, here was the big deal. Gideon was in private during this time. Listen to me. We can never rise above in public what we are in private with God. Going in public will either reveal that you've been with God or you haven't been with God. You can never rise above public that which you are in private with God. And so he's getting this peace about him. And you say, well, we live more in New Testament times for us. I agree. And there's that occasion where Jesus said to the disciples, in the world you will have trouble. But then he says, but in me you will have peace. He's saying, look, there's never going to be a cessation of hostilities. There's never going to be a time when you aren't anxious. And of course you're anxious. We're all anxious. I pray for all of you who may have battled through the COVID-19. I've had two wonderful people that have been close to me for years and years in my life. I've had church members who've battled through the COVID. We pray for everyone who battles through the COVID virus. And I realize that it's been a very distressing time, but I want you to know that God will never waste what he's allowed you to be able to go through. And Jesus said, so, hey, in the world, hey, y'all, you're going to have trouble, but I'm telling you, in me, you're going to have peace. You're going to have that peace. And you see, that's the whole key. And Jesus is saying, I'm going to be right there with you. See, peace is a sense of deep-rooted tranquility based on order in the middle of your situation. If God has come before me, and God is right here with me, and God now goes before me, then God is my order. He's going to bring me through. Gideon begins to turn a corner here. He is no longer the despondent Gideon. Instead, he's now the dependent Gideon, and he builds that altar, and he realizes, look, private worship prepares us for public power from God, and there are no shortcuts. Have you been holding on to something that keeps you from being who God wants you to be? And listen, it's okay to have doubts, because honest doubts are the front porch to true faith. You know how you go on the porch before you get to walk into the house? Well, honest doubts are going to be there. Because Gideon, in the midst of all this, Gideon rallies troops and gets ready, but then he gets nervous. He gets nervous down in verses 36 and 37. And I'm not going to go there, but it's called the fleece. He says about this fleece, "Hey, God, I'm going to run this test." And the first test is that the fleece stays like dry. I want to make sure I'm going to put this, you know, fleece out here on the threshing floor. And if dew is on the fleece that I'm putting out and all the ground around it is dry, then I know you're going to deliver Israel. And so he puts God to a test. And God can be awfully patient with us. And he says, okay, so here's the test. And the Bible says in verse 38, the next morning he went out, and the fleece was wet, and the ground was dry. This is when Gideon sort of turns into the doubting Thomas of the Old Testament. Because then he turns around in verse 39, and he reverses it. And he says, okay, when I get up in the morning, let the fleece be dry on top, and then let the ground be covered with dew. And God turns around and does exactly that for him. Because you know what? All of us struggle in our faith. Hey, y'all, it's okay. It's okay. And faith, that's our reaction to God's ability. Well, it's an amazing story. It really is. I have so much more I could tell you. I'm not even going to tell you about the battle. You need to go read the battle, and you need to remember when they put those torches in there, those jugs, that the Apostle Paul says that the treasure of God is in earthen jugs like us, and we're supposed to let our light out change the world. Golly, I've loved being with y'all this morning. Let's pray. Father, I already prayed for people who need to know Jesus. And I pray today, Lord, that people have accepted your Son into their heart and into their lives. Father, thank you that you're with us. God, never let us lose our ability to believe in the supernatural power of what you can do, because you are God. And I give you thanks for that, Lord, today. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.